Are we doing this one?
Yeah.
Cool. Okay.
That's not at the beginning.
Yeah, it is. That's
is
the beginning.
It is? Oh, okay. Yeah. Well, y'all, I'm crazy.
Go ahead.
I was sure by now, God, that you would have reached down and wiped off. Steps in and save the day. But once again, I say amen, and it's still raining. And as the thunder rolls, I barely hear whisper through the rain. I'm with you, and as your mercy. I raise my hands, praise the God who gives and takes away. And I'll praise you in this storm, and I will lift my hands, for you are who you are, no matter where I am. And every tear I've cried, I will praise you in the
I'm glad we can praise him in the storm this morning. How about you? I tell you, God is good to us. Good to see everybody here this morning. Everybody, blow your horn and wave. Hey, man. Hey, everybody. It's good to see everybody. It's good to see everybody that's watching online. We glad that you're here and joined in with us. Thank you for being with us here at Central Hatchie First Baptist this morning. I tell you, I believe God is good. Amen. I believe that we need to preach him good, a lot of people, and proclaim him good. A lot of people want to talk about themselves. I believe it's important for us to talk about him, amen, and being here together this morning. What a blessing. I wanted to make you aware of a few things. First of all, I asked you to continue to be praying. There have been several deaths in and around our community this last week. We have had three funerals here at the church this past week. And there's another one here in the neighborhood that has passed. Brother Freddie Duncan, they're having his visitation this afternoon. For those of you who don't know Brother Freddie was Kim Harper's stepdad. So be praying for that family today, asking God to take care of them. Also, Miss Sherry called and wanted us to be praying for Jared. He is going to be having surgery tomorrow. So please be praying for those there. And there's many others. The list would go on and on and on if we were to name them all. But we need to continue to pray. I wanted to remind everybody that we are truly refreshed, renewed, and revived here at Central Hatchie. Say, people, somebody say, what does that mean? Well, during our downtime, you might have seen last night a video I made on this, but during our downtime, we made updates to our facility. Many of you who have been inside have seen we were able to complete some of the work. It was left lacking from our remodel. We had some folks come in and work diligently on that, of which we are thankful. And we got some much-needed work done on the inside. Can't wait for you guys to come inside and see it when everything we get to all clear. But also, we have updated our online presence. As you know, Brother Chuck, he has worked diligently along with others to make sure that we get everything online. We're now streaming every service, and making it all happen is no easy feat. Brother Chuck Lofton jumps through hoops every Sunday in order to get the word to us. So I'm thankful for Brother Chuck and for all that he's done to increase our online presence. We have a new church logo. You'll be seeing more about it. I wish I had it in my hand. I meant to have a copy of it in my hand where I could show it to you this morning. But our new church logo, it'll go on everything that we are doing here at the church. You'll be able to readily recognize it. And what it does, it depicts of how we as friends come together to lift up, and family, friends and family, come together to lift up Christ inside and outside of the walls of the church. I feel like it is important for us and others to realize that ministry doesn't just happen inside of the four walls of church. As a matter of fact, what we're doing right now is evident of the fact that ministry is actually outside of the walls of the church as much as anywhere. So our new logo, it'll depict that. We also have a brand new website that we just launched last evening. As you go to centralhatchiefirstbaptist.com, you'll find that there is a brand new website. It's been totally redesigned, brought up to speed. Check it out. If you go on there, you'll find, if you go to our info tab, you'll find everything that you need to know. If you're watching online, you've never visited before. If you go to the info tab, you'll find everything you need to know, from parking in the parking lot all the way to our connection corner that we have put inside, all the way from our little kids downstairs to our senior adults in the back. You can find out everything at our connection corner. From our sermon tab, you'll be able to go to our live feeds on Sunday morning, and you'll be able to find our sermons from 9 to 12, find out, be able to listen to our sermons. You'll also be able to watch on YouTube, go from the sermon tab, go to YouTube or Facebook, and you'll be able to watch our sermons there. Now, I want to make everybody aware. I told you all that to say this. When you go to centralhatchiefirstbaptist.com, you may not immediately pull up. You may get an error. Well, when you get to the error, don't click off of it and say, well, I can't get it. If you'll look at the top, you'll find it's got the three little hash marks, little lines. Some people call them the hamburger symbol. If you'll click on it, it will carry you immediately to the website. I think that you will find that this new website will be easy for you to use. I think you'll like it. Also, I think that you will be proud to share it with others. So just a lot of things have been happening during our downtime here at Central Hatchie. So just a few things to catch you up. So I want to invite those of you who are not here this morning, those that might be watching, to come and gather with us, whether it's at 9 o'clock at our morning service, a drive-in service, or whether you come at 11 o'clock and come inside to the fellowship hall. I'd like to invite you to come on out to the Lord's house and gather together once again in His name. He says where two or three are gathered together in His name, He'd be in our midst there also, and I believe it He certainly will, so I certainly want to invite you to be here and worship together with us. Let's go to the Lord in prayer now, and we will resume. God, I just thank You for the day. I thank You for all that You do for us. I thank You for loving us, caring for us, providing for us in every way. I thank You, God, for the privilege and of being able to gather together and corporately worship You. I pray, God, today that everything that we say and everything that we do, that You'd just be high and lifted up. I pray, God, knowing that You said and You're promised in Your word that when You're high and lifted up, that You draw men unto Yourself. I pray for the drawing of the Holy Spirit of God this morning, Lord, that You draw people back into a closer walk with You, for that when it's lost and undone without You, God. I pray that right now, that before this service is over, that they would be drawn to a saving knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ. I pray for that one that might be away, that one that might be struggling, that one that's living with depression or disappointment. I pray, God, that You would touch them in a mighty way. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. All right, this time I'll get back out of the way.
I am redeemed.
shake off these heavy chains, wipe away every stain. Now I'm not who I used to be, because I don't have to be the old man inside of me, because his day is long dead and wrong. Because I've got a new name, a new life, I'm not the same, and the hope that will carry me home. I am redeemed, you set me free. So I'll shake off these heavy chains and wipe away every stain. I'm not who I used to be.
Good morning, y'all. It is so good to be in the house of the Lord this morning. Amen? Mm-hmm. Okay, this morning we're going to be singing Nobody Loves Me Like You, because nobody loves us like Jesus does.
Oh, what a song to sing.
I wanted to say something real right quick. Okay, so in one of the in the song it says, "Mountains, you are breaking down the weight of all my mountains, even when it feels like I'm surrounded." There is this verse that it reminded me of in Psalms 3. Let me pull that up real quick. Okay. Oh. Give me 1 second to flip to it real quick. Okay. I'm going to read Psalm 3 real quick. It says, "Lord, how are they increased that trouble me? Many are they that rise up against me. Many there be which say of my soul, there is no help for him in God. Selah. But thou, O Lord, art a shield for me, my glory, and the lifter up of mine head. I cried unto the Lord with my voice, and he heard me out of his holy hill. Selah. I laid me down and slept. I awake, for the Lord sustained me. I will not be afraid of 10,000s of people that have set themselves against me round about. Arise, O Lord, save me. O my God, for thou hast smitten all mine enemies upon the cheekbone. Thou hast broken the teeth of the ungodly. Salvation belongeth unto the Lord. Thy blessing is upon thy people." Selah. And that song just, or in the song, that's just, it reminded me of that, you know, that it's easier said than done to, like, you know, Our minds can be filled with fear sometimes, but we forget how true God is to us and how faithful he is and how strong he is, that he is the Alpha and the Omega and the beginning and the last. Amen. Yes. And sometimes before I start singing on Sundays, or like when I would do devotions at school, I would always, I remember sometimes I would just stutter all the time and because I was so nervous, but then I remember, you know, Moses, like, he had a speech impediment, was it? Yeah. And, you know, God used him to change the world. And, like, you know, sometimes fear, we let it hinder us. Yes. Thank you, Miss Ashley. We let it hinder us and from what God has planned for us. So just remember that no matter what the devil puts in your mind, no matter what comes our way, that we always have a God who loves us and will always love us. Thank you.
All right. How about that? Is that working? All right. Well, take your Bibles, if you will. As you know, we've been going through the book of Romans. If you will, and turn with me to Romans chapter number 2. We're gonna be starting and reading this morning in verse number 17. Romans chapter 2, verse number 17. Here's what the Word of the Lord says in Romans chapter 2, verse 17. "Behold, thou art called a Jew, and retest in the law, and makest thy boast of God, and knowest his will, and approvest the things that are more excellent, being instructed out of the law, and art confident that thou thyself art a guide of the blind, a light of them that which are in darkness, an instructor of the foolish, a teacher of babes, which hast the form of knowledge and of the truth in the law. Thou therefore, which teachest another, teachest thou not thyself? He's writing and he's talking to the Jews, and he's telling them there, as he's, I mean, not the Jews, but the church there at Rome, and he's speaking to the Jews about how that the Jews claim to be God's chosen people, which is truth. They are God's chosen people. But then again, as we go through this morning, I want you to remember that he chose you also. But look what else he said. He says, they were testing the law. They make us thy boast of God. They knew what was right. They knew God's will. They even give their stamp of approval upon doing what was right. The Jews did, those that were under the law. But then it gets down in verse 19. It says, even talked about the people, they're confident that thou thyself are a guide. Listen to this. Of the blind. It's talking about the Jews were confident that they were a guide to the blind. How many people do we find that they are confident in the fact that they're living in such a place, in such a way that they can be a guide to the blind? Let me interject something right here before we move forward. Years ago, I was pastoring a church away from here, and as I was pastoring this church, there was a young lady who had come out of a very troubled lifestyle. She had absolutely turned her life around. She had been in the ways of the world. She had been a lady of the evening. She had she had a lot of things that she had asked the Lord to forgive her of. But there was a couple of areas in her life that she was struggling with. And I was in the process of counseling with her and sharing the Word of God with her, when in the midst of that, on into the scene comes one of her friends from school, which was a teacher. And as this teacher comes into the scene, this teacher comes in, and instead she started to teach her something that was contrary to the Word, claiming that it was of the Word. Friends, I got news for you. That's how the Jews were. They had enough half-truths. They knew half-truths. And what they did is they told this young lady that one time that she had repented of her sin, that they were forgiven forever. Now, I agree with that to a point. But the bottom line is simply this. Well, if I get saved today and I decide to go out and I do something that's wrong this afternoon, I believe in repentance. I believe that if I go out and I live in sin and I live in open sin, I believe that you need to repent. Not that it'll send you to hell, but it'll separate you from a relationship with God. And that's where that young lady was at that time, because she had had some sin in her life that had come in since she had been saved. She was struggling with it, trying to deal with it. And this other person says, oh, you ain't got to worry about that, which was totally contrary to the Scripture. That's a lot of times is what the Jews were doing. He said, you, listen to what they said again here. It says this. He says, thou knowest his will. Thou provest the things that are more excellent, being instructed out of the law. They had the law. They had been instructed by it, and are confident that thou thyself are a guide of the blind. In other words, we can tell other people how to go, a light of them which are in darkness. And verse 20, an instructor of the foolish, a teacher of babes, which has the form of knowledge and of the truth of the law. Did you notice it said a form of knowledge? Thou therefore, which teachest another, teachest thou not thyself? Thou that preachest a man should not steal, dost thou steal? Thou that sayest a man should not commit adultery, dost thou commit adultery? Thou that abhorrest idols, dost thou commit sacrilege? Thou that makest thy boast of the law, therefore breaking the law, dishonorest thou God? For the name of God is blasphemed among the Gentiles through you, as it is written. For circumcision verily profiteth if thou keep the law. But if thou be a breaker of the law, thy circumcision is made uncircumcision. Therefore, if the uncircumcision, which is a keeping of a ritual, by the way, keep the righteousness of the law, shall not his uncircumcision be counted for circumcision? And shall not uncircumcision, which is by nature, if it fulfill the law, judge thee, who by the letter of the circumstance do thou transgress the law? For he is not a Jew which is one outwardly, neither is that circumcision which is outward in the flesh, but he is a Jew which is one inwardly, and circumcision is that of the heart, in the spirit, and not in the letter, whose praise is not of men, but of God. What this is talking about is it's talking about people who are religious. Do you know anybody that is religious? I have people all the time coming up to me and say, well, Brother Mark, maybe I'm meeting them for the first time, and for the first time I'm sharing the gospel with them. I'm trying to share my faith with them, and they'll look at me and they say, well, Brother Mark, what religion are you? Well, I got news for you. Religion is something that you do religiously over and over and over again, and religion will send a person straight to hell. Because when we feel like it, we are doing something, in the Jews' case here, following the law, making sure that they didn't break it. All right, y'all got me again? All right. Where'd I leave off at? Technical difficulties. Listen to this, so let's back up. A person who is religious is a person who professes religion. They say that you must adhere to a certain things. You must do something religiously. For Christianity today, a lot of people says, hey, you'll know I'm a Christian because I come to church every Sunday. I got news for you. You don't become a Christian because you come to church every Sunday. You don't become a Christian because you read the Bible every week. You don't become a Christian because you pray. You don't every day before you eat or before you go to bed. You don't become a Christian because you go out and you work in a soup kitchen or something like that. Friends, I want you to know something. A religionist, my friend, may know all of the ways of God and fail to know God. There ain't nothing wrong with praying. There ain't nothing wrong with reading the Bible. There ain't nothing wrong with coming to church. There ain't nothing wrong with working at the soup kitchen. There ain't nothing wrong with doing any of those things. But if those are the things that we're counting on the wrong thing. And that's what he's talking about here in Romans chapter 2, starting in 17, all the way down through verse number 29. You see, he professes religion. He said, look at me. Look at what I'm doing. But I want you to also know this. Most of the people who profess religion fails to live out what he professes. What do you mean by that? Well, let me ask you this question. If a person is religious, that means he does something over and over again. What happens when he fails to do that? Feels like he falls out of the sweet graces of whoever he's doing it for. So therefore, he feels like a person who is a religious fails to live out what he professes. Look at verse 21 and 22. That's what the writer's saying here to the people there. Therefore, thou therefore which teachest another, teachest thou not thyself? In other words, you're not living up to it. You're not following it. You're not doing what you claim that everybody else needs to do. Have you ever seen some Christians who love to criticize other people about how they're living? I got news for you. There's only one way that you get saved. There's only one way you go to heaven. There's only one way you have a relationship with him, and it is through the blood of Jesus Christ. There's no other way, and you can't be religious and get it. You have to have a relationship with a holy God. I want you to know that a person who is religious believes that a ritual in this case here that it refers to in these scriptures, circumcision is the only way to secure God's approval. And they believe that if they follow a certain ritual, that they'll get God's approval. Let me ask you this question. Do you think that God is going to allow me into heaven because I come to church every Sunday? Do you think God's going to let you go into heaven because you come to church every Sunday? Do you think that God's going to allow you into heaven because you read your Bible once a week or once a day or on break while you're at work? Do you think God's going to let you there, but in there because you have done that? Do you think God is going to let you into heaven because you prayed every day? No. The only reason that God lets us into heaven is because we have entered into a saving relationship with Him. There's no other way. Now, being good's good, but praise God, it ain't what gets you into heaven. Look what else he goes on and he says there. Look what he says as we read down through here. Thou sayest a man should not have committed adultery. Do thou commit adultery? Yeah, in a lot of ways, a religionist will commit adultery on a regular basis. How so? He's not entered into a true relationship with God. You see, a person who is religious misses the whole point. See, the whole point is nobody can live good enough to go to heaven. Friends, I got news for you. When we read the scripture, we go back in Romans there, it says there's none righteous. No, not one. Not one. Not me, not you, not the Pope, not anybody else is righteous enough to get. Billy Graham, as good as he was, wasn't righteous enough to get into heaven. The only way into heaven is through the blood of Jesus Christ. Listen to this. He goes on, and let me share this with you. Over the last few days, I have had the privilege and honor of being asked by several families to preach their loved one's funeral. Now, over the last 6 months to a year, God has instilled in my heart that in every home-going celebration, every funeral, if you will, that I preach, I read the 23rd Psalm. So I would like for you to take now, if you have your Bibles with you, if you're looking at it on your phone, and turn with me over to Psalms 23. We all know it. We learned it as a young person. We know the 23rd Psalm. We know it very well. But I would like to go through it with you this morning in relation to what we're reading there in Romans, as Paul is writing to the church at Rome, talking about the fact that a person who is religious is in a mess. Listen to this. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. When we read that very first verse, now, I want you to know there's people all over the world that absolutely love these verses. But I want you to know something. I feel like that there's many who fail to understand these verses. Let me explain this to you. It's amazing to me as to how many people have become religious when a loved one dies. You ever notice that? They become religious when a loved one dies. And that loved one that passed was religious also. Now you say, Brother Mark, you're trying to be judgmental. No, I'm not. No, I'm not. But I want to tell you what the Word of God says. When we read this 23rd Psalm, if you find it, it starts off talking about the Lord is my shepherd. What is it talking about? It's talking about having a relationship with a holy God. He's my shepherd. I want you to see the person, how personal it is. It's not just the idea of a God, but it is a relationship with God. He knows him personally. Here's what he said. The Lord is my shepherd. Now I want you to think about a shepherd for a minute. A shepherd, my friend, is one who tend a flock, and this, and as it alludes to here in the scripture, a flock of sheep. Now, I want you to understand something. The Bible also says, God says, my sheep hear my voice. You remember that scripture? And they know it. Friends, I got news for you. Simply what he's saying here in Psalms 23, verse number 1, the Lord is my shepherd. I belong to the Lord. Do you know how important it is for you and I to belong to the Lord? Everything in this walk of life hinges, and life eternal hinges on the fact of having a relationship with the Lord. They might say, Jesus is my Lord. You see, as we read this, we might say, Jesus is my Lord. But I want you to know this. As we read this, he said, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He's referring to the fact that not only is he belongs to him, but he talks about through this relationship how he will provide for him. Friends, I got news for you. Everybody out there doesn't really necessarily know the Lord in a relationship. Some are religious. I shared this with some people before, and I've shared it with you before, but I want to share it with you again. I love to fly. I love to be around Brother Jesse Bell. Y'all know I've been to Oshkosh with him and everything else. Brother Jesse loves to talk about them airplanes, and I guess I'm still just a kid at heart. I love to talk about them airplanes. I could take an old balsa wood airplane and still spend hours and hours in the yard flying that old balsa wood airplane. Y'all remember putting them together as a kid and playing with them? Man, I love them airplanes. But you know what? I have read all sorts of books on airplanes. I know all about airplanes. I know about airfoils. I know about lift. I know about yaw. I know about drag. I know about how you got to figure the center of gravity. I even studied how to triangulate before they had all this modern GPS. And I know how to triangulate to be able to figure out our position as to where we at when you can't tell where you are. But anyway, I studied all that. And you know what? I studied everything about how to check that airplane out, how it works, all the things, what all the instruments mean, what they're supposed to do, and everything about flying. But you know what I had never done? I've never flown one time. And because I you know what I can do? I can go and I can sit. Now, I am not a professional by any means, but I can sit and have an intelligent conversation with you about airplanes. However, it does not make me a pilot. If you think it does, I'll ask you this. How many of you want to go up yonder to the airport? We'll rent us a plane. We'll go for a flight. I'll be the pilot. Anybody want to go with me? I dare say most of you don't want to get on board with me. Amen? But you know why? Because I'm not a pilot. I know all about it. I can talk about it. And you know what? I might could fool somebody into thinking that I was a pilot, but that don't mean that I am. Oh, the person who is religious, my friend, may fool people into thinking that they're a Christian, but I got news for you. We have a holy God who knows absolutely everything, and they know whether or not you have a relationship with him. He doesn't fool people. Listen to this. What's going on? When we listen to this, I want you to understand, as we're reading this psalm, the person who's writing it, he's simply saying, he said, I'm just a common man, and I've got a relationship. And I want you to see this, and I want you to know this. That relationship is available for everybody. When we go down through here, I want you to know this. In this relationship, I want you to see how this relationship with his shepherd, I want you to see how it changed him. First of all, he said that I shall not want. That shepherd in that relationship provides for the physical needs. The physical needs will be met. Everything that you and I now have, if we're born again, we know that everything, every good and perfect gift has come down from the Father above. So we know that he is meeting our physical needs. Not only that, but I want you to see there where he talks about the green pastures. That's, again, his physical needs. But then I want you to see this. I want you to see that he leads you beside the still waters. This right here is a reference to your emotional needs. When you enter into a true relationship, when you become something other than religious, all of a sudden you're not putting out an act for everybody to see it, where they can hear how spiritual you can talk, where they can't hear how biblically knowledgeable that you are. Instead, what you'll find is, instead of you having to put out a persona of who you are, instead what happens is God's personality invades your heart and he meets your emotional needs. I don't know about you, but I'm thankful for that today, because I can fall into a ditch pretty quick. Amen. Listen what he says. Emotionally, I can become a wreck, but in the moment that I think about him through the relationship, a true relationship with him, I find my emotional needs being met. Look what else he's met for him. In verse number 3, it says, he restoreth my soul. What does that mean? It means that he is meeting the spiritual needs of the individual in whom he has a relationship. Look what all of his living needs are met. Listen to this. The path of righteousness. He leads us in the path of righteousness. Our living needs, our daily walk needs are being met. Our it talks about the shadow of death. That's our deepest, most troubling things are taken care of. Listen to this. It says, yea, though I walk, he's then through the valley of the shadow of death. What is this talking about? It goes to talking about when a person is in a true relationship, his eternal needs are met. Look what else he says in that verse. He says, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. And then it talks about this in verse number 5. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil. My cup runneth over. He's speaking of an eternal relationship with him, and how that from the moment that he enters into that relationship, God meets his needs, physical, emotional, spiritual, and eternal. And friends, I want you to know, it says in verse 6, surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Friends, I want you to know something. This man was physically satisfied. This man, he alludes to the fact that he is emotionally satisfied. He is spiritually satisfied. He is physically satisfied. And he is eternally satisfied. Now, I got news for you. Those sheep know their master's voice. They know the shepherd's voice. The reason that they come and follow that shepherd's voice is because that shepherd has been tried and trued by those sheep. Let me explain to you. I got a drove of cows over yonder at the house. And do you know what? When I first put them cows in the pasture, them cows, I could go out there and I could call them till I was blue in the face. And they might raise up and look at me. They might not. But I got an uncle that used to ride out there on his little old four-wheeler, and he'd bring a loaf of bread with him. And every time he rode out there with that loaf of bread, I'd walk out there to the fence, and Uncle Billy and Bert, they would take and they would feed them old cows loaf bread. I don't know if y'all know this or not, but a cow loves loaf bread. They develop a taste for it. And Uncle Billy could ride out through there with his four-wheeler, and them old cows, they would break from the backside of the pasture, and they would run, because that four-wheeler, they equated with the sound of the voice of the shepherd that was taking care of them. See, the shepherd had provided for them. Uncle Billy had fed them things. He had took care of them, and they knew his voice, and they came to him. Friends, I got news for you. As we read Psalms 23, what we find is, he says, the Lord is my shepherd. Friends, I got news for you. I want to be something beside religious. I don't want to just be able to talk the talk. I don't want to just be able to say hallelujah at the same place in the psalm. You ever notice somebody's religious? They'll holler hallelujah at the same place in the psalm every time. I won't never forget, Renee and I was at a visiting a church a few years ago while I was on vacation. And I'm going to tell y'all what, We was sitting there in that service, and y'all know I don't talk about folks in service a whole lot, but I want you to hear me on this. I won't say where it was at, and it ain't no concern. But we walked in, and in the sanctuary, this one old feller, he's sitting there, he's eating peanuts and drinking the Coca-Cola. That's his business. Another one's over there, they just laughing and a joking and a carrying on, all sorts of stuff. And there's a big old countdown comes on the screen up there. It's counting down to the service. Well, we do that sometimes here, but what I want to share this with you, there ain't nothing wrong with that, but let me tell you what happened. Everybody, the house was just, it was loud, it was music was playing loud, people were just all over the place, and dead square on 10:45, that's when the countdown got to zero, that drummer run a roll across them drums, and when they did, everybody was in their place in about 2 seconds, and by the time they sang the first word of that song, they was up all over the house with their hands raised, and talking and just hollering hallelujah and everything. I got news for you. I ain't making fun of them, but I want you to hear this. They were being religious because the Spirit hadn't moved them that quick. Amen? They hadn't heard it that quick. The Spirit hadn't just jumped on everybody. Friends, I got news for you. God don't need some ill-mannered religion. What God needs is some people who will enter into a true relationship with Him to come to know Him in the free pardon of sin and live like they know Him. They asked that scripture there in Romans. He asked them this, how can you teach other people and not teach yourself? How can you live by the Word of God and tell others how to live by the Word of God and how good God is if you don't live like you believe it yourself? Friends, I got news for you. I believe it takes more than lifestyle evangelism in order to reach people for Christ. But at the same time, I believe without a shadow of a doubt that it takes lifestyle evangelism to go along with the words that comes out of your mouth. What do you mean by that? I believe that you ought to practice what you preach. Amen? Unless you have a relationship, you're just religious. And God wants more than just religion. God wants to know you. And He wants to know you personally. As Paul writes to the Romans, he talks about the Jews. And he talks about how important it is for them not to just follow the letter of the law, but to know the lawmaker by faith through grace. Father God, as much as I know how, God, I have delivered the message you've given unto me today. I pray right now, God, that you would just take it, search people's hearts, direct them, God, in your word, draw them closer with your love. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Maybe you're here today, and just in a minute they're going to have an invitation. And as we have the invitation, maybe you'd like to just step out of your car and come right down here. And maybe right there at home where you are, you'd just like to bow your head. And maybe, you know what, you've been doing things religiously. And maybe you've had a relationship with Him, but whatever happened, you've sort of got away from that. Maybe you want to come and rededicate your life to Him today. Whatever you need to do, I would like for you just to be obedient as the Holy Spirit pricks your heart. If you're there at home, just bow your head. Just draw near to the Lord. Just talk to Him. Ask Him to restore you in the free pardon of sin. In Jesus' name.
Step down.
Is all hearts, minds clear? Anybody, anything this morning? Thank you for being here this morning. I pray that you have a wonderful week. I ask you to continue to pray for our services. Just remember, check out our new website. And for those of you who wanted to know, asked earlier about their giving, they can still, you can give here at the church. You can give during the 9 o'clock service here, or 11 o'clock in the back, or you can give online. Go to our new website. When you find it, you go right down through there, you find a button that says giving. Click on it and it'll lead you right through it. Also, if you'd like to snail mail it, that address is still 35 Lofton Lane. Thank y'all so much. We look forward to seeing y'all in the days ahead. Can't wait till we can get all back together again. Y'all be praying for the school. We have sent out several emails. If I fail to get it to you, I'm sorry. I'll be working on that. But we have got a different school we're praying for every day. I will see if make sure that we get those emails out again for this upcoming week. But thank you for your prayers, okay? God bless you. Have a great day. We love y'all.